Breakfast puppies?
We're all set to begin, so let's dive right in to bikers, dice, and bars. Talking bicycles and motorbikes, gamer things and all the like. You can listen to it in your cars, but mostly it's about dive bars. Bikers, dice, and bars.
Hey, Poppy, what are we drinking now?
Oh, goodness. We are drinking something very special this evening. We are drinking a bottle of Nika whiskey, gold and gold.
There's so much armor on this bottle.
Oh, that's pretty.
You know what that smells like?
I love the anticipatory look that was on your face as you were reaching for that glass.
Literally had the glass in my hand for maybe a second before an NPC impatiently was just reaching out for it. Like, why isn't this in my hand yet, you asshole?
Teleport that thing.
Now, I understand there's a story about this.
Oh, yes. Yeah. Yes. So there's a story behind this bottle, this beautiful bottle of whiskey, which is wearing some gorgeous metal samurai armor on it. We're going to have pictures of that.
And by the way, it's not chintzy plastic. It's metal.
It's metal. Yeah.
You could harm somebody with that.
I'm thinking that's going to be a really good like Halloween costume for our little kitty cat. So I'll try to tell the short version of this story. Battle cat. Yes. His name is Kikuchio.
I think this might be an all-time record.
We already broke Jacob. We're not even a minute in. We're like 57 seconds in.
Fucking yes. Excuse me.
While Poppy's telling the story, I'm going to go dye the cat green with red stripes.
No. Anyway, okay. So back in May, I made a very last minute, somewhat emergency trip to Osaka, Japan to go visit a friend of mine who is very ill. He's currently living there temporarily. He's getting a cancer treatment there that they don't do in the United States yet. And I hadn't seen him in some time. And I decided to, with the help of a lot of my friends and family, make this very last minute trip to Osaka. And I was only there for 4 days. And like you do when you go overseas, you know, this was my first time crossing the date line. I'd only ever been to Canada and Mexico. This is my first time crossing the big pond. Like you do when you're in Japan, you want to bring home some gifts for your loved ones. And I was actually in the Kansai airport on my way back to Portland. And I was walking through the airport and I turn and there's this duty free shop. And I turn out the corner of my eye. I see this bottle of whiskey wearing samurai armor. And I literally turned on my heel like almost 180 degrees to go back into this duty free shop. And it was only like, I'm trying to remember exchange rate. It ended up being about $50. So it's like 5,000 yen.
I don't know.
I think it's 100 to 1. Anyway, so it's like, it was like really easy. Cause I was like, move the decimal point over by 2. Okay, I can do this. So it was only like $50. I was like, oh my God, I have got to get that for Nathaniel. Because A, samurai, B, whiskey, everything about this was like NPC. So I turn on my heels and go in there and I get my bottle and they tape it up all nice for me and, you know, da 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 da. And I take it on the airplane. I do my 12 hours from Kansai to LAX. And then I get to LAX and I go, shit. How am I getting this back to Portland? Because they don't care. Osaka to LA, they don't care if you bring a giant bottle of liquor on the airplane. It's no problem. I had to recheck everything.
Oh, you had to go out of security.
I had to go out of security.
Okay, I was going to say, that shouldn't be an issue unless you had to go out of security.
How I managed to hack my flight was I got 4 one-way tickets to get the best time and the best price. So nothing was checked through.
Got it.
And all of my stuff was carry on anyway, because I was only going for 4 days and I was terrified of losing my shit or whatever.
Sure.
So there I am in the LA airport. I've been awake for 20 something hours and I have to unpack all of my stuff Luckily, I had like a 3-hour layover, so it was pretty easy. Well, 4-hour layover. So anyway, short version, I had to unpack all of my stuff. So I'm in the LA airport, like my dirty underwear, my dirty clothes, and just everything got all over the goddamn place. And I was just out of my mind with like stress and jet lag and just anyway. But I managed to get it into what was my carry-on, check the carry-on, check the regular suitcase, and get it back to Portland after much suitcase Tetris going on.
Speaking of things that are not going to fit in your luggage, you're listening to Vikers Dice and Bars, recorded here in Portland, Oregon, as usual. I am NPC.
I am just Jacob.
Dr. Xander Gerrymander.
Poppy Beaujolais.
And today we are drinking Samurai Whiskey.
Yeah, woo! Mika Whiskey. I actually don't know anything about this whiskey company. I haven't even looked it up. Does anybody else know anything about this whiskey other than the fact that it's
well, it's gorgeous? Japanese, it's so it's going to be a single malt whiskey because that's what they do.
I did see it was aged in wood. Wait, let me read the little front thing here because it's pretty great. No, the front of the box here.
Okay.
It says, superb whiskey aged in wood guaranteed by our own experts.
Well, that's nice.
Yeah. Oh my God.
What?
Masataka Taketsuru, it was the founder founder. And first of all, he's a handsome, handsome man.
Ooh.
Like, handsome.
Oh, dang.
Yeah. Like, that man could buy me dinner.
He's beautiful.
But yeah, they have a whole lot of brands. Oh, look at that distillery. You have to check. This is all off their website. It is way cool.
The N-I-K-K-A.
Yep.
Whiskey. Mm-hmm. W-H-I-S-K-Y. No E. Correct. Yep.
Yeah. They're awesome.
So a few years ago, I wrote and published a role-playing game called Moto Bushido, the game about motorcycle riding samurai. It's a fun game. It's a lot. I love the game. I run it a lot. It's one of my greatest creations. But because I did that, everyone thinks of me as that guy who really likes samurai a lot.
Mm-hmm.
So it's basically a self-fulfilling prophecy. Now, all I get are gifts about samurai.
Including some pretty darn good
whiskey. Is what does this taste like, y'all? What do we think?
Well, it's not sweet, actually. I take that back. It's very
it's funky.
Well,
but not in a bad way.
So
sharp.
It's called a whiskey, as it should be. But in flavor profile, it reminds me of a really, really mild Speyside Scotch.
I was going to say Scotch.
Without the smoke, but like a Speyside Scotch, which is still sharp, but has a little bit of fruit to it, you know, softer on the palate, but still with a bit of bite.
Yeah, I mean, I'm not the biggest fan of Japanese whiskey because I think it's a little bit too perfect.
Oh,
not dirty, smoky, and peaty enough for you.
That's part of it. And the other part of it, too, is generally speaking, they tend to distill their whiskeys multiple times to kind of get out more of the pure
impurities.
But yeah. That also kind of takes out some of the flavor and profile I tend to find anyways. However, I would drink this any day of the week.
Yes. Spoken like a true Tom Waits fan.
Yeah.
And it just looks so cool. Mm-hmm.
I would keep this on my shelf forever. I would fill it with other whiskey and then just keep the bottle.
I want to just like take this little guy on adventures with me. I want to like snuggle him.
This is your lawn gnome.
I want to snuggle him as I go to bed. I really like this little samurai guy.
Tweakers would steal the hell out of it off your lawn.
No. I mean the lawn gnome that you go and take pictures of at places that you have gone to.
I see.
That lawn gnome.
Yeah.
Well, perhaps we'll make that happen. This time around, we're doing things a little bit off the format, kind of breaking out of our usual pattern here. And instead of doing like a 3x3 breakdown of different topics, we're just going to dive into some things that have been interesting us this year. So, hey, Xander, what have you been watching recently?
I didn't realize until about a month and a half ago, due to certain hectic things in my life, that one of my favorite TV shows had come back for its final season.
What show is that?
It's called The Last Ship. Hmm. And it went up to season 4, I think, then stopped for a couple of years because one of the actors had like a mental breakdown or something. And then it came back and I didn't realize it wrapped up last November. And I went, oh, I've not been watching the show for years. So I had to rewatch all of it. And now I'm a few episodes away from the very last episode. It's a fun show if you like the kind of post-apocalyptic genre. And I sure as fuck do. It's a good show. The premise of the show is that the U.S. Naval destroyer, the USS Nathan James, is sent out to the Arctic to conduct weapons testings up there. They are on radio silence. And they just happen to have some virologists on board for no reason. No reason.
Some what?
Virologists, those who study viruses.
Gotcha.
And out of nowhere, the Russians attack them. They fire back, take out a couple of their helicopters. They go, are we at war with Russia? And no one told us. They finally break radio silence to find out that a virus has devastated most of the world's population while they were been away at sea, hence the last ship. There is no more Russian government. They are now breakaway military factions that are trying to find these virologists to get the cure. And they go escapading across the globe and find a very, very devastated world.
Fascinating.
Yeah.
Five seasons.
Last season just finished up November of last year. I like the show for a number of reasons. Again, it's post-apocalyptic. Love that shit. It also has a lot of interesting moral questions that it asks a lot. I like, too, that it's one of the few TV shows out there that has decided that, oh, I'm sorry, are we in China? They speak Chinese. So a lot of subtitles to read. So most of the foreign languages that are spoken there are spoken with subtitles because that's the way things work. They're not just people with accents of that country and they pretend like they don't understand the language.
I really appreciate when that happens.
I like it too because they have a lot of very prominent characters who are either female or they are lesbian or gay or they are people of color because the world has collapsed and you need everybody to help. It has a lot of interesting geopolitical things that go along with it, too, including a lot of history of American imperialism as maybe why no one trusts the Navy. But it also shows, too, kind of, you know, the bonds of, you know, sailors and soldiers and Marines and airmen and Coast Guardsmen and whatnot. And even amongst nations, like the respect that certain sailors will have for other sailors and whatnot. So it's phenomenal.
Bobby. And it is called The Last Ship.
Yes.
And where can people watch this?
I'm watching it on Hulu right now. Okay. I believe it might be on Netflix, too, but I don't have Netflix, so I don't really know. The only quibbles I really have with the show, it's one of those shows, like most shows, where, like, you know, when one of the main characters gets shot, like, they have the really sad, agonizing death when they get their last words out, whereas all the baddies just kind of go down in two bullets. Mm. My only complaint, really. Aside from that, it's great.
That said, I mean, have you grown attached to the baddies?
I mean, the baddies who are like main character baddies, they take a while to die because they also got to get their last words
exactly.
out.
Exactly.
You know, yeah. Okay.
So ones that have actually had character development get a little bit of a death scene.
They're dramatic death.
Okay.
But even, you know, not super main characters that are some of the American sailors, for instance, like they get shot and it's really agonizing. Just like emphasize you should feel for them. Whereas like your average Russian baddie just kind of goes down and dies. Hmm. So that's my only complaint, really. Great acting on the show. Couple cheesy moments with like, you know, oh no, we have a family now and the world is dying but you know, whatever. Like it's realistic, I guess. I just don't really care.
That's pretty much how it is.
Yeah. Yeah.
These days. Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah. Good dramatic scenes. Lots of scientific lingo that I don't know if it's accurate or not. And I don't really care because it seems like it's smart. But yeah, that's one of the shows that I've been binging on a lot. Again, on a few episodes from being done and I've liked every season so far.
Well, definitely check that out. That actually sounds really interesting.
So up until June of this year, I was living in a house with no internet, no television. So my viewing has been heavily limited. And
nothing important has happened since 2013. You're fine.
Anyways, with that said, I've watched a lot of documentaries, but most of my television viewing has been my sweetie getting me up to speed on Doctor Who. And there's so much eye rolling going on.
Doctor Who cares, right? Am I right? Hey. Probably. I just lost most of our fans.
Nerdy ninth all month long.
All I'm going to say is that I am coming to the end of the 11th Doctor, or no, 10th Doctor, about to go into the 11th Doctor. I'm a War Doctor Forever guy. Billy Piper is so far the best companion. And that's about it. I mean, I totally get all of the people who don't like modern Doctor Who, I get where they're coming from. There are some real suckers of stories. But it's kind of nice because most of my BBC watching has been dramas and crime dramas. And so seeing them go off the chain for something other than Red Dwarf or Blake Seven.
Can you clarify for our listeners which BBC you're referring to?
Well, I mean, I watch all of them. I mean, to be honest, I watch a lot of this Scottish-influenced stuff, but, you know.
That wasn't the joke I was making, but please, go on.
Yes.
What joke were you making, NPC?
I'm choosing not to acknowledge one of the possible options.
Dear listener, go to Urban Dictionary and look up BBC sometime. Anyway, moving on.
No, God.
Oh.
Yes.
I just clicked.
Yes. I'm going to ignore that that happened.
Yeah.
So this would be
what a dick.
BBC One and the Welsh BBC, apparently. But, you know, that's been a lot of it. Other than that, it's been all scattered documentaries, that sort of thing. If you want recommendations for really, really bad alien conspiracy and Illuminati
aliens.
The show conspiracies, private message me and I'll hook you up.
Well, like many people, I have been currently binging the second season of Mindhunter on Netflix. And if you're not aware of what Mindhunter is,
and I'm only loosely aware of what
it is.
I know it's a show.
Yeah, it is a show. It is on. I'm watching it on Netflix. I can't remember if it's a Netflix original or not.
I believe it is.
I think it is. But it's basically a dramatized version of the founding of the Behavioral Health Unit of the FBI. So you see the creation of the Behavioral Health Unit, the creation of even the term serial killer. The idea of profiling is kind of being born in the, you know, 10 years or whatever that this is kind of happening. And it overlaps with the, you know, the main characters who are the folks who work at the FBI and their kind of process. And it goes into their kind of emotional process as well with the work that they do. And you also get to see them interviewing serial killers who are currently behind bars, which is fucking fantastic. And apparently a lot of this really happened. But again, the TV show is dramatized to a pretty big extreme.
Because watching actual science take place is a little boring.
Right.
And takes a long time.
Yeah. And they also, they follow a serial killer who is currently active through like flashbacks and, you know, et cetera. And it's it turns out to be the BTK killer.
Oh.
Yeah. So it's kind of them.
The BFK killer?
The BTK
killer. I was going to ask what he had against that drink, but
no. BTK. So fine torture kind of, kill.
Fine. Yeah.
I thought it was like Big Texas Cock or something like that.
Okay. Cock with a K?
Hey, Texas.
It's from the
Texas. Texas fine. Actually, he was in Kansas.
Yes.
But anyway, same I think difference. Was he also known as the Green River Killer?
No, Green River no, Killer.
Was a different
was
person
Washington.
Altogether. Okay. And anyway, so yeah, you follow them like trying to figure out how to catch the BTK killer, and you see BTK doing his stuff and all this. And Lord have mercy, the actor who plays Ed Kemper is amazing. And the actor who plays Charles Manson is amazing. And it's a very well done show overall.
So I have not seen the show yet. It's one I want to see because Holden is one of the guys I started following early in my development.
Holden Ford.
Yeah.
Yeah.
And
who wrote the book that this is based on?
Yeah.
Yeah.
Also, if you're looking up this show, you're looking for Mindhunter the show, not Mindhunter the movie, which is a prequel to Silence of the Lambs and Red Dragon.
Right. Different thing altogether, but inspired by.
But from what I have heard from other people in the aberrant psychology, abnormal psychology field who have looked at some of the case files, the portrayal of Ed Kemper is like to a T
on. Spot on.
Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah, it's eerie. And he's also oddly endearing. It's fantastic. I highly, highly recommend. Obviously, it's pretty violent. Lots of content warnings. It's about a serial killer, you know. But amazing.
What level of violence are we talking? Are we talking about realistic violence, or is this like Kill Bill blood spouting?
Realistic, like seeing the aftermath of really horrific things being done to humans and children.
So like Seven.
Ish. Yeah.
It's like Seven if they hard-pegged everything to R, from what I'm hearing. I mean, there's stuff that they do in the show that they could not get away with in a movie theater and still keep an R rating.
Oh.
Oh, yeah. Lots of naked people, lots of case file photos of horrible things that have happened to people. And
Remember, this is the United States. You show a penis, you get an X rating.
Heaven forbid.
Is this just the dick episode?
A lot of dark humor, too.
Nice.
Well, pulling away from that darkness a bit.
Yeah.
I've recently acquired a library card.
Yay!
One of the benefits of the library card is that they actually connect to a number of streaming services.
Wait, what?
Yes.
And there's one called Hoopla, which is both movies and shows and audiobooks and ebooks, but also comic books. And we'll get to that in a minute.
And music.
So do you have to use the Hoopla at the library, or is it a thing you can just take home and use it because you have a library card?
Yeah, you just connect your library card.
Holy cow.
There's Hoopla. There's another one called Canopy. There's another one called Overdrive.
Yep.
They're all different services to get like anything from movies to comic books to audiobooks to music to actual books and more.
Folks, we're going to do a special outtake that if you're a Patreon, you'll might be able to get where NPC and I just geek out on what the modern library has to offer. It'll be a quick in and out, but both he and I mean, he's learning about the wonders of the modern library. Yeah. I am a well-experienced, but look for that in the Patreon feed.
It also should be said, too, that outside of the New York County Library, Multnomah County Library here in Portland has the most active library base of any city in the country.
I will agree with that because evidence is showing me when I'm looking through all the various listings of things on these services, you can frequently sometimes you can see, depending upon the service, what demographic of people or at least of library region are checking these things out and watching it. It's so much of is coming from Multnomah Library.
Yep.
Anyway, I've been watching The Great Courses on Canopy. So Canopy with a K is one of the services that connects to your library card, and you can watch six things for free a month. And it's almost all movies or animated shorts, and some of them are like big theater movies, but a lot of them are art house films or documentaries or really old classics and masterpieces.
Or foreign films.
Lots of foreign films. The Great Courses don't cost you anything at all to watch. You have unlimited access to thousands of hours of these. They're basically lectures that have a little bit of production value to them. And they're really fascinating. The one I have been powering through is called The Greatest Military Blunders of History.
And it sounds fun.
Starts from the beginning, from like BC times, and just goes through these various like recorded battles. It talks about the buildup to the battle, all of the things that led into it, then goes day by day through like breaking it down into what the decisive blunder was, or multiple in many of these cases were usually just inept generals who were not just inept. They were prideful and they just failed. Like, oh God.
Seems so hard to believe that generals be full of pride and blunder and just stubbornness. How dare you,
listening
sir?
Listening to all of these collapses of civilization caused by these epic blunders of military history. It's ridiculously fascinating. Then he goes through beat by beat, focusing on those blunders afterward, talking about what we can learn from them.
Mm-hmm.
And then sometimes he even looks at what we still have not learned from mm-hmm. them, as decided by the next episode. It's really
amazing.
It's really good.
That's a good connecting piece.
Yeah.
Do you have a favorite so far? A favorite blunder?
My favorite?
Oh, yeah. Good question. Oh,
okay. I'm going to be interested in hearing what yours is.
My favorite one is, it's... Yes.
Just don't attack Russia in the winter. Just don't do it.
I forget the actual year, but it focuses on a man who is in many, many, many ways known as one of, if not the greatest military tacticians ever to live. Care to guess, Jacob?
I'm going to go Alexander, but I'm trying to remember because I watched these. I listened to these a while back, and I can't remember whether you're going to reference Hannibal or Alexander.
Subutai.
Oh, yeah. Okay, that
Subutai,
one.
Subutai, the military strategist and right-hand man of Genghis Khan.
Mm-hmm. I thought that was Conan's sidekick.
Maybe.
Maybe.
Subutai, food for wolves. Remember? Yeah,
Subutai was it is Subutai, right?
It is Subutai.
Yes,
I'm pretty sure.
Now you've got me questioning.
Yeah, now I'm questioning.
Right, but I'm pretty sure it's Subutai. He was
okay.
He was considered by many to be the greatest military strategist ever because this man conquered more countries, won more battles, and led more men to victory than any other human being ever to live on this planet.
Wow.
Anyway, the blunders of that episode aren't his. They go into the blunders of his opponents and how he used those blunders against them.
Amazing.
Like, oh, you idiot. You're going to make you pay for that one.
It is an amazing watch. The guy who, all of the great courses are pretty cool. And each one is done by a different speaker professor.
Mm-hmm.
So you never really know with the cadence or if you're going to kind of vibe with the person. But of the two that I've listened to so far are the ones on military blunders and another extended course focusing entirely on the Etruscans.
Oh.
It's just fascinating material to sit and half watch because you're mm-hmm. mostly listening to it. But mm-hmm. then stuff pops up and they annotate the battles with like circles and arrows on the back of each side to be used in a court of law against them.
So I am into the great courses since we got Canopy in the Multnomah County, and now I'm in Washington County, and you still have access to Canopy, so I still use that. I love the great courses. I made the mistake of trying to do I will listen to them as I'm relaxing before going to bed. That was a great way to stay up till 1:30 in the morning.
Would you call that a great military blunder?
No, that was a great managing your life and adulting blunder.
Well, I'm going to give you a quick hint here. Does your Multnomah County library card still exist?
Oh, no, Washington County has Canopy, too. So
but does your Multnomah card still exist?
I would never, ever, ever consider defrauding my former library system by double dipping.
Just saying, if you are a member of multiple libraries, your credits add up.
Yes.
It's awesome.
Uh-huh. That's not fraud.
Yeah. I have one more show that I would like to mention, unless anybody's got something else. This one I just finished last night.
The Hollow.
You seem excited. I think you should just go for it.
Yeah, you should talk about
it. It's called Ginlock. It's by Rooster Teeth. They do Ruby and Red versus Blue. It's only 8 episodes, but it's the most like well-produced thing that they've made so far. It's amazing. And it's got so many names in it that you would recognize. Like Maisie Williams is in it. Dakota Fanning is one of the actors in it. And it's an animated show about mecha pilots in a far future where another nation is conquering ours and they are kicking our asses. And then these mecha pilots, who are, of course, teenagers who have to, learn to put up with each other and synergize and beat up the enemy. Well, the choreography is just amazing and the animation's amazing. And like everything Rooster Teeth does, the dialogue and the pacing are just top notch. Really good. I cannot wait for more.
There was another show that I found recently. It's not a new show, but it was a show that I just never looked at because I don't know why. But it's called The Brink. It is one season. It is about 10 episodes, I want to say. So it's a pretty easy watch. The Brink is a political satire show that takes place mostly between Washington, D.C. and Pakistan. Mm. And it starts off with this lowly member of the embassy, played by Jack Black, who
amazing.
Who keeps trying to go and get favors done by one of the drivers who works there, who's native there, who's played by Asif Manvi.
Mm.
And it ends up turning into a really, really horrible political incident as Pakistan goes through a coup d'etat and the completely inept U.S. government tries to go and fix it with, like, the inner rivalries between the Department of Defense and the State Department go and just go at each other's throats. Tim Robinson plays the Secretary of State.
Oh, my God.
Tim Robbins.
Yeah, it's actually produced by Tim Robbins as well.
Nice.
It goes from being pretty funny to really, really dark, so
we're
really, really fast.
Sucker proxy Tim Robbins.
The very same, yeah. Buddy.
Oh. My Rocky Horror friends will get that reference. Tim Robbins. That's for you, friends.
But anyways, it's a quick, easy watch. It is hilarious. It's dark. There's some silly, goofy moments. There's some sweet moments. And then there's just, you know, oh my God, this is the ineptitude of our government moments. It doesn't make you feel safe. But it's funny.
And Poppy, you were mentioned a show a few minutes ago.
Yeah, The Hollow. I actually just finished this the other day.
Wait. Is that the one with where the kids wake up in the shed in the middle of nowhere?
It's a bunker in the middle of nowhere.
Okay. There is a shed as well.
Yes. Three teenagers.
Yeah, okay.
I think three, yeah. Teenagers / young adults.
They're teenagers.
Yeah. They wake up in a concrete room.
Young adults.
With a typewriter. Yeah. They can't remember their names.
They don't
know why they're there. And they basically try to figure out what's going on.
Challenge for you. I watched the first episode and couldn't figure out a reason why to keep watching. Sell me on this.
Good question.
I mean, the art style was okay, but...
I actually found the art style to be the most annoying aspect of it.
Really?
There were certain things I didn't like about it. I didn't like the way they drew girls.
Yes.
Because all of the characters had normal faces and lips, but every female character had, like, Bratz doll makeup.
They look like Bratz, right.
And
kind
I was like,
of, yeah.
I just, it didn't like that. It was like, I wish that they could have, you know, made everyone kind of based on the same template and then worked it from there. But it was seemed like super.
It's almost as if they were inspired by anime.
OK, so anyways, I mean, like, I could go on a whole rant on what I didn't like about the first episode. Sell me on why I should continue watching this series.
It has a very, to me, and I hope you get this reference, my fellow Gen Xer here. It has a very Liquid Television feel to it.
Yeah,
I did notice that.
Okay.
That was one of the vibes I liked.
It has that very Liquid Television feel, and it's what I really like about it is that the audience is as clueless as the characters. We're learning things as they learn things. There's no, you know, there's no backstory, there's no explanation for a lot of things. And we're learning. So you get to have this fun of like, okay, what's going on? And you get to have your little theories and whatever. And it's just.
So explain the show for the audience. Yeah.
Hold on. Jacob, did you get to the part with the easy bake with the Beaver Cleaver witches?
No. I mean, like, I watched the first episode and went, why would I go on from here?
It's like when I tried to watch Buffy the Vampire Slayer. I've got one episode and I just went, nope.
Well, okay. So. The first episode, like many first episodes of many things, is rough, but it sets up the basic premise of what you're getting into.
Correct.
It wasn't until the second episode with the Beaver Cleaver witches that it's like, oh, God. Okay. I see what this is about because it got dark real quick.
And I don't want to say too much because part of the fun, like, don't look up anything about this show before you watch it.
Do not read about it.
Okay.
Yeah. Don't read about it. Don't read up. Anything about it, just watch it on Netflix.
Turn it on, start watching it.
Yeah. I think it's rated vaguely PG, if I remember correctly.
Yeah, there's some violence
PG,
in it.
PG-13,
yeah.
I think. It's not TV-MA. I couldn't remember exactly what
the rating
is.
There's one character in it who's extremely annoying at the beginning, but he comes around.
The blonde kid?
Yeah.
Oh, yes. I wanted to drown him.
I was like brown haired, but he was like, oh, he's whining the whole time.
Yeah, I wanted to drown him.
Okay, so here's the thing. He's the everyman.
So in the dark right now.
He is the everyman character.
And now you know why Jacob just despises mankind.
And friends, not everybody is good in an emergency. And you need learn how to manage people who freak out instead of go into...
Slap them.
Instead of going to emergency mode. And I think that shows that really well.
Mm-hmm.
Anyway, we enjoyed it all the way through to the end.
Yeah.
Also, I'm going to have to recommend a movie now.
Okay. We're on to movies.
We're on the movies. I have seen this movie 3 times now in theaters.
Whoa.
If I could find someone else to take it to, I'd go see it a fourth. Jim Jarmusch's newest film, The Dead Don't Die.
Ooh.
I want to see that. You can take me.
If it's still in theaters, I will take you.
Hooray.
The Dead Don't Die might have the most ridiculously good cast of any movie ever of all time. So for those who don't know, Jim Jarmusch makes very slow-paced films with phenomenal casts. This is probably the fastest-paced film that Jim Jarmusch has ever made, and it still starts off real slow. However, it is a zombie film that takes place in a place called Centerville, USA. No state ever said. Basically the middle of this country. It's half a buddy cop film between Adam Driver and Bill Murray, being two police officers in this small town who get pot shots taken at them by this crazy hermit that lives in the woods named Hermit Bob, who's played by Tom Waits.
Oh, shit.
Because it's Jim Jarmusch.
Because it's Jim Jarmusch. Because Tom Waits whenever he fucking wants to.
Oh, amazing.
Tom, I need you at 5 p.m. on Thursday.
All right.
Okay.
Only if you can get Bill this time, though.
Yeah.
He and I have a score to settle.
But anyways, you learn within the first 15 or 20 minutes that this diner gets attacked by zombies. And unlike most zombie films, it doesn't take half the fucking movie for them to go like, well, let's call them like walkers or something. And I don't know. And what's going on? Adam Driver, after the first attack, goes, I don't know. I'm thinking zombies. Like, so it exists in a world where they know zombies exist. So they cut off all that fucking bullshit off the bat. And it ends up being this kind of buddy cop film, like kind of weird environmental message film with a lot of just like fatalism about the whole thing as well. But Iggy Pop shows up at one point.
Oh, dear.
Oh, yes.
You've been holding out on me.
Okay, so you're going to come to this movie too?
Yes.
Yeah. Iggy Pop's in there. Rosie Flores is in there. Tilda Swinton is in there.
I mean, it's a Jim Jarmusch film. It'll probably come to Canopy. Just saying.
And it's called what again?
It's called The Dead Don't Die. It's also super meta, which was very, very weird to me. And I'm still trying to figure out why it was so meta, like what the purpose of it was. But if you've seen the film, you'll know what I mean. I don't want to spoil the meta moments for you here on the podcast because you have not seen it. But yeah, just weird. Ooh.
It's playing at the Academy Theater tonight at 9:40.
That's not happening.
That's not happening.
No. I'm an old man.
I don't have anything to do tomorrow till 10.
If it's playing tomorrow night, I will definitely consider taking you out to see that on my way back from work.
Any other movies? I don't really watch movies. Like, the only movies I watch typically are ones I have to be forced to watch.
So other than my sweetie getting me up to speed on the Marvel Cinematic Universe in order to be able to see Endgame, which I'm not going to reference here. I'm going to reference a movie that I really, really enjoyed. I'm not one for biopics. I would rather watch a documentary about the biography of someone I'm 100%. Interested in.
Yeah, me too. Totally.
I will make an exception for this one. It's called Tolkien, which is apparently the proper pronunciation of J.R.R. Tolkien's.
Tolkien.
Tolkien, because of his ancestry.
I can't say Tolkien without thinking of rifts.
I totally hear you. Totally hear you. Guess why they chose that.
Yeah.
It is a biopic about the life of J.R.R. Tolkien, and it is surprisingly good. As someone who can't stand biopics, it was amazing. It goes into his service during World War.
I was just going to ask.
One? Yes, it does go into World War One. It goes into his backstory and the group of people he grew up with. It's a real hit. There's actually a bunch of female characters, and none of them are portrayed particularly badly, which is really nice. And I highly, highly recommend it.
I got one last one I'm going to recommend here. Speaking of World War One, this one is a documentary, and it is They Shall Not Grow Old, and it just came out. It came out in theaters here, I think, this year, but it was released in November of 2018.
Now, is that the one with, like, the restored footage?
Oh, yeah.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah.
So, basically, the Imperial War Museum of the United Kingdom gave Peter Jackson everything that they had to make a centennial anniversary documentary of World War One. The only thing they said, though, is you have to make it different than any other documentary. And he went, I don't make documentaries, but sure, let's see how we can figure this out. So, for starters, there's no commentary of a narrator.
Awesome.
None whatsoever. All of the narration is done by interviews done with World War One veterans of the UK that they did, like, in the 1950s.
Wow.
Remembering their time as basically children on the battlefronts of Europe, because most of them were like 14, 15, or 16 when they lied about their age to get into the war. Mm. And Peter Jackson took the 100 hours of film that they had and decided, well, I got a gazillion dollar studio. I'm going to HD the shit out of this. So he goes and he makes it full blazing color HD as best as he possibly could, frame by fucking frame. And not only for the 2-hour documentary that it is, but he also then applied it to the rest of the 100 hours of photography or the video that they took. Oh. And then he goes and puts sound effects to it. So, like, you hear the artillery explosion, and it's so brilliantly set up because it kind of goes from start to end. So it starts off by, like, you know, like the panic in England, and then people lining up to recruit, and then them doing training and everything. And then all of a sudden you see tanks coming across the line.
And what's it called again?
They Shall Not Grow Old. It's based on a poem written about World War One, about how those that they left behind shall not grow old.
Ooh.
Yeah. Whew.
Get any levity to bring us here?
Well, I'm gonna mention three movies that I've seen in the last, I don't know, year or whatever. I don't go out to the movies terribly often, and I'm gonna let you all decide which ones you want me to talk about. So it's a little dealer's choice here. Do you want me to talk about Bohemian Rhapsody?
No.
Maybe.
Just hold on. Bohemian Rhapsody, Game Night, or Vice.
Game night.
Sure. Let's make it unanimous.
Game night. You know this crowd.
It's true, but Vice, holy shit.
Vice is...
Oh my God. My soul. Oh, okay, anyway.
Yeah, I said levity.
Yeah, levity. So we're going to talk about Game Night. So Game Night was a movie that MPC and I decided to watch one evening just kind of as a like, why the hell not? It's been in the queue for a little while. We're not really sure exactly. The trailer looked funny, you know, whatever. And it actually ended up being a pretty damn good movie. It's about, I don't know, vaguely speaking, it's about this group of people who kind of get together. They're what, in their mid to late 30s.
Yeah.
Get together. They're trying to, you know, stay social and, you know, have a weekly game night or whatever.
And it's all board games. There's a relationship story involved, how like the main couple are like both very competitive gamers. And
yeah.
They played all the games apparently. And yet the only games that they ever pull out in this movie.
Settlers of Catan.
I was just going to say that.
They don't even go to Settlers level.
Oh God.
Oh, we're talking God. Milton Bradley, Parker Brothers.
Yeah, kind of Monopoly, basic party
Scattergories.
Games.
Pictionary,
Uno.
Like,
they met at a trivia night, you know, on opposing teams. Like,
this is like the ultimate white people game.
Yeah, it's Jason Bateman and but Rachel McAdams.
Yeah,
if that gives you any kind of
little hot Yahtzee accent going on.
Be prepared to cut this. Are they Mormon?
No, they're just.
God damn it, Jacob! We just lost Utah.
They're kind.
Not as long as Utah is the state that watches the most porn on the internet.
Mm. Well.
Anyway, Jason Bateman and what's her name?
Rachel McAdams.
Rachel McAdams.
Anyway, so they are. Yeah. So the main character played by Jason Bateman has this kind of ongoing sibling rivalry. Sibling rivalry with his brother. His brother is always. you know, doing the most interesting thing is the most successful. And meanwhile, Jason Bateman is living this like quiet but successful sort of suburban life, but kind of boring or whatever. And his brother decides that the one night for game night that he's going to step it up, and they're going to do this like kind of LARP murder mystery kind of thing. And basically it all kind of goes to shit. And
you should watch it to find out what happens.
Hilarious antics ensue. Yeah. Lots of
and
twists.
Then things happen.
Yeah, lots of twists and turns. And it wasn't actually quite what I was expecting.
You know, it did not go where I was expecting
it
to
really
go.
Good
yeah.
way.
In a good way.
Yeah, so give it a shot. It's not as formulaic as you might think. And that was a really fun...
We were dying laughing.
Yeah.
We were guffawing.
The neighbor, the creepy neighbor is just...
I hadn't laughed that part since Superbad. Yeah.
Yeah, it's a good sort of nerdy date night kind of movie.
Well, let's take this off the screen and onto the page.
Ooh.
Jacob, what have you been reading?
Well, other than tons of stuff for work, tons of stuff for organizational development.
That doesn't count.
Well, I mean, it's when one of the games you play the most of is Run the Con.
Shit.
Yeah. Or you're running a side hustle as a organizational consultant. I have actually been
reading... Is that
LARPing?
No,
well, sort of. It's running LARP, but getting paid.
You're going to have to cut this. State health insurance is kind of like LARPing.
Oh, God. Don't even. Okay.
Okay. Sorry. Cut that.
So
that's not getting cut.
I tend to read a lot of nonfiction, but at the moment, for a variety of reasons, because I need to turn my brain off, I've been reading books from the Four Horsemen universe, starting with Cartwright's Cavaliers. And it is, if you like mechs...
I do like those.
Yeah.
If you're not opposed to one of your main characters being a brony.
Friendship is magic.
And you're not opposed to the entire concept being kill aliens, get paid.
Okay, I'm back.
And
I'm confused.
When we say aliens, back. We are talking interstellar aliens.
Okay, thank you for the clarification.
It's not a bad series. Chris Kennedy Productions is the producer, and Chris Kennedy is the overall author for most of them, but it's a shared universe. It's quick, it's light, and it's really good. Beyond that, the only other thing I've been reading is my sweetie and I have been sharing the reading of the original Lord of the Rings series.
No.
Are you reading it aloud to each other?
Yes.
Oh.
Well, actually, I'm reading it aloud to her, but same difference.
No.
I will say that one of the cutest things I've ever seen so far while working at my job, and it was the best bar for it, too. I was working at the little red shed at Edgefield, and there was a couple that spent 2 hours of her reading him Harry Potter because he'd never read it before. Because this is the one bar on the property that doesn't have any outside music or television, so it's just natural noise out there. And she was just reading him Harry Potter for hours, and they were just slowly sipping drinks. It was adorable.
So you need to send me your work schedule, and my sweetie and I will be out.
Yes.
That's amazing.
Absolutely.
Bobby?
I have two series that I've really just devoured in the last year. Well, one is not a series yet. The second book is actually coming out next month. So the first book is called Carry On, and it is by Rainbow Rowell. And is a spinoff from her other book called Fangirl. What are you laughing at?
Rainbow fucking Randolph.
Rainbow Rowell.
Keep going.
Okay.
Is this like a pseudonym for Poppy Zebright?
I have no idea if that's her real name or if it's a pseudonym or a nom de plume or okay. whatever. I have no idea. Anyway.
As a Gen Xer, I've known many people who were cursed with the name Rainbow.
Oh, same. Yeah. So Carry On is sort of a spinoff from one of her other books called Fangirl. Anyway, the Carry On is basically the last book in a series of kind of vaguely Harry Potterish books, but a lot darker. And the chosen one is like the worst chosen one that ever happened. And I've actually listened to it as the audiobook, and I highly recommend listening to it, the audiobook, versus reading it, because the voice actor who reads the audiobook does the accent and the cadence and the vocal style of the main character extremely well. And I don't know if it would come across on the page as well as it does with somebody actually speaking this kind of quote unquote lower class British accent. So Carry On is if you liked Harry Potter, you're probably going to really like Carry On, because it's just a lot. It's a lot better. It's a lot darker. It's really twisted. And the second book is coming out. The second book is called Wayward Son. Yeah, Carry On, Wayward Son. Yeah. So that's coming out next month, and I'm very excited. I've pre-ordered the audiobook. I'm very excited about it.
I, too, used to watch Supernatural.
You know, it's a wizard school. There's vampires. There's evil forces. There's a twist in the end. It's, you know. And the other series that I've devoured in the last year was the Glittering Court series by Rochelle Mead. Now, bear with me here.
Uh-oh.
Because I've read. Okay, guys, I love me some urban.
No, pour me more.
I love me some urban fantasy romance smut. And Rochelle Mead has.
All right, make it three fingers.
I know. Just the level up there, guys. Rochelle Mead has written some amazing urban fantasy romance mystery smut in the Succubus Blues series. Some shaman kicking ass face.
Hold on.
And, oh my God, they're doing right. So much. But I said,
I'm listening now.
Here.
I'm listening now.
She's most famous for writing the Vampire Academy series. Okay. So the reason I bring that up is I have read a lot of her stuff, and it tends to follow sort of the same format. So when I started listening to, I do a lot of audiobooks because of my ADHD and my dyslexia and blah, 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 blah. I started listening to Glittering Court. I was expecting her same kind of like formulaic stuff. I was expecting sort of like a puff, like YA teen kind of romance, like historical romance kind of crap. And that is not at all what it ended up being. On the surface, it looks very much like it's going to be some kind of young teen fluff kind of crap. And it's really not. I don't want to say too much without giving. I don't want to give a bunch away. But if you stick with it, it's actually the characters are really well developed. The characters are not stereotypes. They're all really strong women. It's got a very nice feminist kind of thing going on. And they're just good, fun stories. And I was very pleasantly surprised, especially by the second and third books. So Glittering Court, Midnight Jewel, and Emerald Sea.
I'm not going to judge because, oh my God, do I read trash?
That's the thing is on the surface, it looks like trash. And it's not. And that's the cool thing about most of Rochelle Mead's stuff is on the surface, it looks like trash. And then when you get in, there's some really deep, complicated, like cool shit going on.
Now, NPC, I know you read a lot and I know you read better stuff than I do nowadays.
Maybe. You know,
definitely.
Bringing it back to that library card. Yeah. I have made use of the Hoopla service.
Which I highly endorse.
A shitload of comics,
mm-hmm.
including one that I had always been meaning to, but never got around to, which is Saga.
Ooh.
I started reading it yesterday. I made the mistake of starting reading it before going to bed.
Whoops.
And I've got all of it on Hoopla. All of it. In fact, they have it all condensed into the 3 omnibus editions. So I just checked each of those out and boom, that's 3 rentals for the month out of like 10 or something.
Nice.
I'm almost done.
Whoa.
I'm not sure if it's still the case. I'm not sure if it's still the case that they have it on Hoopla, but check. And if you haven't, work your way through Strike Force Moratari.
That sounds familiar.
Yeah, it's, yeah.
Anyway, Saga's a great comic series, science fiction, but it's very well written. The character dialogue is just fucking spot on. Yeah, read it. It's Saga. Like, you've probably fucking heard of it because it's like the current comic epic that is out there. And the other thing I've been reading is an old book, one of the first fantasy books I ever fell in love with as a kid. And I started reading it again to get inspiration for a game I'm running. It's a book by a writer named Dennis L. McKiernan. The book is called Dragon Doom. It's very Tolkienian in style and flow. In fact, McKiernan got his start. He has his own world, fantasy world called Mythgar, which was initially meant to actually be Middle Earth because he had wanted to continue writing published stories in the Middle Earth world after the Lord of the Rings. And his agent was like, look, well, the Tolkien land, Tolkien, whatever, the estate.
Middle Earth.
Yeah, the estate is not going to let you do this.
No.
But I like what you've written, so let's file some things off and publish it as your own new world. And he's written dozens of books in this world of his now.
Holy crap.
Yeah.
Just wanted to say that Mythgard just kind of sounds like a brand of armor you would get before you go into a dungeon.
I've got Mythgard on my side. No, it's insurance.
Yeah, so that's Mythgard insurance.
Yeah.
So that's Dennis L. McKiernan. Yeah. That's
McKiernan.
Okay, so I am going to be looking this up.
Yeah, it's very Tolkienian in style. Huh. It reads like Tolkien. It's got the same flowery prose. It's got song in it. It's got the
dance.
Might as well. But you feel like you're on a grand adventure in it, but not one of those like revenge driven modern HBO written fantasy stories. Mm-hmm. It really feels like a plucky group has gotten together and the weight of the world is on their shoulders and now they must go forth and do a thing. And it's a lovely adventure.
So I had a really hard time reading Tolkien because of the like, we're going to spend three whole pages talking about tobacco.
You would hate McKiernan.
Okay. Yes.
That's McKiernan the same reason just carries that forward.
I couldn't abide by George R. R. Martin in 3.5 pages of talking about the food they're about to eat.
Or the women they just raped, because that's what Martin does.
Right. Yeah. Okay, so I will probably stay away from that for the rest of y'all. Go crazy. Do you, boo.
Xander, what have you been reading?
The Economist.
Okay, so next, what have you guys been playing?
So you also read The Economist. You and I will compare notes over beers.
Of course we will. But aside from...
Hello.
Ladies and gentlemen, dear readers, make sure to go and get a good subscription to good journalistic sources because it's important in this day and age. Anyways, also, I've been reading through slowly during slow times at my work, Death and Company.
Oh, good choice.
I'm going to take it a completely different direction from all y'all.
Oh, yeah.
Have you ever heard of or been to Death and Company?
I don't know what you're talking about.
It's my latest business venture. Death and Company. Death and Company is probably the best cocktail bar in New York City, if not maybe the country. It was founded by these guys who just wanted to make good cocktails but not make them intimidating, which is really tricky to do if you're a snob.
Yes.
So after a while, they went and wrote this book called Death and Company. It's not about their bars so much as it is about the concept of bartending. It's meant for bartenders to go and read.
And it's meant for bartenders to go read, not mixologists. Go fuck yourself.
Fuckers. Piss off.
Wait, mixologists? Is that a word?
Yes.
Oh.
Let me tell you, there are people in this country that will show you their business cards with that as their job title.
Jesus fucking Christ.
Go die in a hole.
I go to dive bars almost exclusively these days.
Precisely for this reason, perhaps?
Oh, yeah. I'm just going to tell you, you're in Portland. Some dive bars have their cocktail menu curated by a mixologist.
Okay, first off, those aren't dive bars.
You'd think.
No. Yeah, they're not. Any place that calls itself a dive bar, like that puts it on their card, isn't a dive bar.
Right.
No.
Yeah. Agreed.
Yeah.
They're a theme bar.
Yeah.
Anyways, so they put out this book, and it's actually really interesting because it is a book where if you're a baby bartender and you're just getting started, it's actually a really good jump off point for resources. If you're an experienced bartender, it will still teach you things you have not learned before.
Or you have forgotten.
Or that you have forgotten, which is another good thing, too. And if you're a really experienced bartender, it gets into some really nitty gritty details about, you know, the differences in stirring spoons and the different types of stirring vessels you might want to procure and, you know, the differences between the types of ice you might want to use and the best machines to purchase for them.
Whoa. In some ways, the narrative aspects, it goes a little bit more into technical detail, but in the narrative aspects, I would describe it as the Kitchen Confidential of Ooh. Bartending.
It's just a phenomenal resource. And what they have, they'll go into the entire history of gin. Mm-hmm. The different types of gin, how and why they're different, their favorite go-to gins at different price levels and why, and then they'll give you a bunch of cocktails at the end. And the other nice thing about this book, too, which I think actually makes it really personal, is that throughout the different chapters of the book, they will go and feature one of their favorite regulars who comes in.
Yep.
Kind of their story, and it's all written by them. So So it's the regular story, how they first found Death and Company, why they keep coming back, their favorite cocktail, and they give you the recipe.
And again, for our listeners, the book is
Death and Company, Death and Co. Technically,
Death and Co.
But Death and Company, yeah, it's a beautiful black bound book, and if you like bartending at all, or interested in it, or just interested in alcohol in general, it is a phenomenal buy.
So let's talk about games.
Yeah.
So NPC, lead us off because you are the gamer with the most.
Okay, gaming, dear God. Let's look at first the easy stuff to talk about. Our roommate and I, Alex, we're playing through.
He's been on the mics, right?
Yeah, yeah. Mm-hmm. He's been in a few.
Alex.
Alex. He
introduced himself.
Yeah, mm-hmm. We are playing Dead Space 3 because it's the third and final of the Dead Space games, but it also is two-player local co-op. Well, sorry. Two-player co-op, not local, but we have two PS3s and two televisions, and we're playing it side-by-side in the same room, and it's actually fucking rad.
That's sweet. That gives me a whole LAN party vibe from my Gen X heart.
Yeah. Oh, I miss LAN parties.
I've also been slowly but steadily making my way through Horizon Zero Dawn. It's on the PS4. It is a perfect game, in my opinion.
Whoa, that is a heavy claim, sir.
And I am savoring it. Because I almost never replay games unless they're Fallout. And Xander gets it, but because I have a couple hundred Fallout characters because you come up with a new thing and you want to start it and try it out.
Well, and there's so many options you can do. Yeah. So many people. Because I don't like actually playing Fallout and having the 15 different companions with one character. I find that boring and also a little bit kind of like cheating on them.
Yeah. But with Horizon, it to me is a perfect game.
What happened?
I think I just made Jacob get whiskey up his nose.
Did you inhale whiskey?
It looks like he did. He's holding his face in pain.
Oh, honey. Ow.
And this is harsh whiskey, too.
Oh, wow. Ew. There is some, swords have been drawn. A rip in space-time just appeared between just Jacob and the good doctor.
In all seriousness, are you okay?
Yeah, I'm fine.
Oh, God. You are supposed to drink whiskey, ladies and gentlemen.
Norovirus is around in Portland, folks. And, oh, God, my sinuses are now sterilized. Oh, God.
Ouch.
Hey, yeah.
Hey, it's about to be, fall. You're inoculated now.
So this is a pro tip for those of you running a podcast. If you have that friend who you never know who's going to drop a zinger on you, don't be drinking
don't
while they speak.
Drink. Just don't do it.
Anyways, back to you, doctor.
I was just saying I would never cheat on Rose of Cassidy. She's just too precious.
Well, anyway, Horizon is to me a superior game. It is a perfect game. It scratches every single itch I have in a game,
and
it never lets me down. It's a good story. It's got engaging gameplay. Mm-hmm. It's got a steady buildup of skill where you feel yourself getting better, and I really like that. But it's not a punishing buildup of skill. It's not you have to die 30 times before you know how to beat this room punishment. I don't like that. Horizon is the kind of game that There's moments where I've cried in the story because the voice acting and the facial animation is so on point. It's a perfect game.
What style of game is it? What is the setting and what are the platforms?
It is a PS4 game only. It is a far post-apocalyptic. Like, the apocalypse happened and now the world is rebuilding and we have like different tribes and whatnot. And this, which you quickly find out you are in post-apocalyptic Colorado. Oh. Anyway, the machines have been like, there was a machine uprising and the machines were quelled and put down, but now the machines are coming back.
Pesky machines.
You're this tribesman girl running around with a bow and
I've seen the trailer for that. Yeah.
Some red hair and some feathers, and it is a rad fucking game.
So post apocalyptic Colorado. So it's Greeley.
We just lost Greeley.
Sorry, Greeley. Sorry, not sorry. I almost said Pueblo, and then thought better of it.
Well, that's my video games.
Jacob's going back for seconds on the whiskey, having clearly not learned his lesson. This is going to be great.
But before we go into tabletop games, what video games are you all playing? Oh.
So I finally, after a while, decided that, also because it was on sale, to go and obtain the Far Harbor Fallout 4 DLC for the first time, because I'm slow. I fucking love it. I think I love it more than the series, or than the whole Fallout 4 game itself. Far Harbor takes place in post-apocalyptic Maine, in a fishing town, so you had me right there.
Nah, Jessica, you can't get that from here.
And my favorite, I very rarely have jumped out of my seat from playing Fallout before. It's happened a few times. Mostly ghouls in fucking vaults, but whatever. Or the goddamn sewers of DC. Anyways.
What about the museum in Fallout 4?
I didn't jump.
With the synths?
Yeah, I didn't jump.
Okay.
However, when I went and found, I'm like, oh, a lure weed, that's cool. Picked one of those, saw another lure weed, picked one of those, saw another lure weed, and then a goddamn anglerfish mutant monster jumped out of the fucking water and tried to rip my head off, and I jumped 2 feet out of my chair to the point where the Mad Marquis laughed at me because he was nearby. And I just went, she don't like this at all. But they have some pretty terrifying aquatic mutant monsters, which make me really happy because I'm a big fisherman, did a lot of marine biology back in the day, grew up on the coast and all around water. So having this kind of much more fisherman, aquatic, seaside town-centric Fallout DLC was most cool to me. Bunch of old fishing boats you can go romp through. And it's just nice to help an old fishing town out. They definitely need the help. Happy to lend it to them.
All fishing towns need the help.
Also, I think I have a fucking harpoon for a gun now. I'm so excited. So fucking excited.
So, Jacob, do you ever get turned that old dust ball into an actual gaming machine?
My poor academic version of Windows 10 laptop. Yeah, no. I am still rocking Jagged Alliance 2 hard.
I couldn't get it to work. On a Windows 10 machine. I tried.
Well, so yeah. Apparently that's a huge issue. There's a very mild tweak to the batch file you can do, but it works on mine, but that's all I'm playing. Jagged Alliance 2 for life. I am hoping that after September, I can actually invest money in getting a gaming machine and then maybe catch up on the last literally 12 years of gaming.
My child, we have so much to show you.
We don't have enough components to just build him one, like hanging around.
Unfortunately,
they all went into a better cause than me.
Oh, okay.
And it was a legit better cause than me. I mean, like, let's be real. Most of my life is spent at best watching my sweetie rock the hell out of Jurassic World that YouTube gifted her.
I need fucking to Lego go game. Play more Lego dinosaurs with her so
no,
bad.
No. Yes, you need to make her come here and do more Lego dinosaurs with y'all.
Okay,
on board with this.
We need to make that happen.
There may need to be a recording where my sweetie is
playing the game while all of us are watching her.
And giving commentary.
And giving commentary after we have eaten an amazing dinner.
While drinking whiskey.
When is this happening?
Well, I mean, A, it would be on the Patreon feed, and B, okay. It should be soon.
And also cooking game?
Oh, yes.
Cooking okay. game being Overcooked, which is our favorite two-player, two-four-player, local, love and also hate your friends video game.
Well, if you're overcooking it, I hate you already, but...
It is a cooperative video game of kitchen management in the apocalypse.
I have heard of this.
Can we talk about games we're excited for coming up?
hold on. I got another game that I want to talk about on the tabletop before we talk about new games.
As do I.
Sure. Yeah. Jacob, what are you playing?
So I am currently running two things. I am running a campaign of The Witcher, the tabletop role-playing game.
Interesting.
Yeah, it's a great group. I have nothing but female-identifying players. And... So our Talsorian recently released the Witcher tabletop role-playing game. It's an evolution of the system they used for Cyberpunk. For those of you who are Gen Xers who have played the system, it's a good evolution. It's still a little bit on the crunch, so you have to invest in the crunch, but it is definitely... reaching in to the Witcher lore, and the campaign's going great. It's awesome. I have two dwarves, a sorceress, and a witcher, and they are currently exploring their world and recently blew the hell out of one hell of a cursed site, so it's going well.
In order to run a campaign, must you have at least a witcher?
No, you don't.
Okay.
In fact, The Witcher actually raises the bar and has made it a little bit challenging to run for, but it's not overbalanced. I have to say the Pondsmiths, both the father and the son, have done a decent job of balancing out all of the pseudo classes that the game has. And I've really enjoyed it. And so far, the group has, too. We're doing a little bit of mid-game tweaks on some of the characters because we're learning as we're going along. But, you know, you have very deep lore because you have all of the books to work from, three games plus the downloadable content and the upcoming series. And it's really good. And more, to be honest... one of the ways I love running is running for mixed groups or blended groups where it's not all a bunch of white dudes sitting around playing. And I frequently find myself in places where I get to run for people who aren't that. And it's awesome. More to the point. Some of the quotes have been amazing, and maybe I'll start posting the best quote of the game after they happen. Also, don't ever, ever, ever let your sorcerers go strictly the fire route.
I've also been running a game. I've picking up where we started with the Forbidden Lands character jam. That taught me a lot about how to not run a character creation session for that game.
You're so, welcome.
Two nights after that, I did the character creation session for my actual weekend campaign that I've been running. And we have our third session this weekend. It's going very well. I'm excited. Yeah. It is unlike any other game I've run before because it has a few built-in... pacing mechanics and leans heavily upon the day-by-day structure, which I've played a lot more free-form games. So going into this whole, what are you doing in the morning? What are you doing in the afternoon? What are you doing in the evening? What are you doing at night? Rinse, repeat, day-by-day flow. It's kind of cool, but it's new to me. But we're having fun with it.
Also, Just Jacob is getting back into one of his old habits, which is running mini campaigns, which are 3 to 5 session games that are all pre-scheduled sessions. It's all set and done. I have scripted out a Delta Green campaign, and I am looking for up to 3 additional seats. So if you're interested...
What is Delta Green?
Delta Green. Imagine the Cthulhu mythos crossed with the deep state.
I have no idea what any of those words mean, but it was English for sure.
Okay.
Basically, all right. It's basically World War Cthulhu, as people have explained it to me.
Yeah, except it's what World War Cthulhu is cribbing from.
Yeah. No, I mean, the theme is basically World War Cthulhu. Like,
yes.
Yeah.
Yeah, yeah, yeah. No, you are a bunch of federal agents in a access-only program that is designed to fight the Cthulhu mythos, except you don't understand anything. And I'm looking for players. Message me if you're interested.
Poppy, what have you been playing?
I think one of my favorite games over the last couple of months has been Escape the Dark Castle.
Ooh, tell us more.
It's not, I don't know, how would you describe it? It's not a board game. It's not a card game. It's not an RPG.
It's technically a board game,
but it's sort of like if a dungeon crawl classics, like a deck building game and a board game, like had a bastard love child. And it's basically a way of creating an adventure kind of on the fly. You know, that comes with all these different cards and characters, sheets and et cetera. And you sort of build your dungeon, and the goal is for your crew who are prisoners in this dungeon to escape. And you have to make decisions, and it's all kind of randomly generated with these cards you put down.
Kinda. You randomly put together a stack of 15 room cards.
Like encounter cards.
But then, and then your group goes through room by room, and each room is like, you have stepped into the kitchen. A large man is clearly chopping some kind of an indiscernible meat. His back is turned to you. There's some meat on the table between you. Just leave, move to the next room. B, try to get some of the food, but there's a chance he might hear you. Roll this. And if he hears you, fight. And yeah, it's got kind of a choose your own adventure flow to it.
It's a little reminiscent of Kingdom of Loathing, but an analog version of Kingdom of Loathing.
I can see that.
In a lot of ways.
It's a lot more gruesome.
It's not quite as, cute. It's not as cutesy as Kingdom of Loathing, but it's, again, choose your own adventure kind of dungeon crawl. And I think we have the entire beautiful set.
Yeah, that was a Kickstarter. So we got the deluxe set,
and it's really nice.
It's the black one that you can't read.
I can read Castle, and that's about it. But it's kind of a fun way to do like a pseudo dungeon crawl, but as like a party game. Like there's not a lot of setup. You just shuffle the cards and you go, and it's pretty fun. And I think we've survived like once.
Once. I think it's really easy to lose that game.
It's really challenging. Yeah. So it's a fun game. Yeah.
You had a game you were excited about that was coming out, Xander.
Two of them, actually. One is Cyberpunk 2077.
Yes!
That one looks like it is, again, almost everything I've always wanted in a game. Nice sci-fi. Cyberpunk's one of my favorite styles of gameplay. You throw in...
Really?
Oh, yeah. No, I mean, that's why I love Shadowrun so much. It's a little Shadowpunky, you know? But I've seen the graphics so far. They look gorgeous. It looks like a good mixture of, you know, combat puzzles and just a really good story and mystery. So that game I'm very excited about. The other one I'm very excited about, which I've been... It definitely was not lying in bed all morning in my underwear watching videos about this, but...
I don't need that mental image.
Yeah, but our audience does.
at least more than 50% do.
At least more than 50%. That's all I need in life. Is Vampire the Masquerade Bloodlines 2. And...
Mm-hmm. Unsurprised.
Unsurprised at all. I am sure I've played all the computer Vampire the Masquerade games. Mixed results, but a still good series overall. However, this one takes place in Seattle. And if you look at the trailer and you know Seattle, they've done a pretty good job at recreating Seattle. And so for that alone, I'm kind of excited about playing the game. It was kind of like why I was really excited about playing Fallout 4 when I first went to Boston going, I've been here before and I don't know why. But it seems like they've done a lot of good things with it. They've have some new interesting concepts to it. The graphics look pretty good so far, even though it's still in pre-alpha. And they're just kind of keeping like the four or like six basic clans is what they're kind of sticking with too. So it's not all over the place. And yeah, I mean, again, it's Pacific Northwest. So it's kind of exciting to have more games that are being made in this area or about this area, at least.
So if you are a Cyberpunk fan, Cyberpunk Red recently dropped a quick starter. It's the latest.
A quick starter or a Kickstarter?
Quick starter.
Oh, okay.
Quick start rules. Like quick pick start up rules. Like five pages on okay. how to play, usually okay, it's a okay. combat scenario.
Okay. And,
I didn't know if you were drunk or not. Sorry.
Well, A, I am drunk. And B, but no, they recently dropped a quick start. And if you're interested, Xander, as a cyberpunk aficionado and want to go a little old school, I mean, you're going to have to go back to the age of rule systems that are slightly similar to when you were in diapers. But we could make this happen and maybe even make it happen on the mics.
I am okay with this.
Excellent.
I accept my fate.
Well, then, I got a question. Anybody played a decent board game lately? Because, to be honest, it has been over at least 6 months since I've played a board game, and God damn it.
Lots of them. We just talked about Escape the Dark Castle. That was a good one.
That's a good one, but, you know, that seemed like a little bit too role-play-y. I mean, NPC, give me a good board game that's come out lately that you've had your chance to hear about.
Man, I'll be honest. I don't follow board games anymore. Usually what happens is I'll go to someone's house and they'll have like a gaming party. And then
so what have you played recently that's been good?
Escape the Dark Castle, actually. Hey. I know
that's
the most recent one that I have acquired in that method.
We should go and have Andy Mesa on this podcast. Because Andy Mesa,
I don't know who that is.
Andy Mesa goes and runs the weekly board game night at my father's place.
Oh, okay.
And his board game collection is fucking insane. Nice. He does keep on top of board games. And so, I mean, he gets the place packed every single night or every week for these things.
I don't play that many board games because most people aren't into the kind of games that I like.
Says the man with Twilight Imperium on his shelf.
That's the only competitive game that I own. I exclusively go for cooperative games because I don't like competition. I'm just not a very competitive person. And I especially hate playing games with competitive people that just ruin the experience. Like, I want to enjoy a good time with friends.
Screw you. Yeah. We are going to win pandemic because I showed you how.
And then there's pandemic.
Oh, dear.
Guys, let's all be friends here.
Anything's better than Catan,
we can be
though.
Friends, just don't make stupid choices.
You don't want to play that, like, Puerto Rico game?
I don't know anything about it.
Is that the one where you throw paper towels at people?
No, you literally trade little meeples. You literally trade little meeples that are painted brown.
That depends on which version you play.
Terrible.
My game sounds better.
Yeah.
Yeah.
This is the last call for alcohol this evening. Drink up, drink up, drink up, and order again. This is the last call for alcohol, get going. Drink up, drink up, drink up, then order again.
Yeah, so anyway, on that note, let's go ahead and kind of bring this episode to a close. This has been a bit more of a free form thing because I'm feeling kind of sick this week and we didn't really have much of a thing planned. So we're just saying, hey, let's talk about things we love.
I'm drunk. This whiskey packs a punch. I was just looking it up online, and apparently in the States, this bottle of whiskey will set you back $250. So you're welcome.
All right.
Hand carried from the Kansai Airport.
So that checked luggage didn't set you back much then?
No. I flew southwest those two.
Yeah, you
got to
grab the bottle. Don't grab samurai armor.
Yeah, don't grab the top of this bottle.
So I was thinking we could get Gregory Mechanic to make a lamp out of that for us.
Maybe. We'll talk.
I don't know. He's real cute.
All I'm going to say.
Samurai.
I mean, Gregory's kind of cute, too.
I mean, he is cute, too, yes, but...
I just want to know, Jacob.
Yes.
Does it taste better through the mouth or the nose?
Oh, fuck you.
How's the nose on that whiskey, Jacob?
At this point, sterilized. I will say, given the color, if you need a color that matches that whiskey, I would recommend Tullamore Dew. Oh. It's about the same color tone, and you can fill it back.
It won't set you back $250.
Yeah.
Well, yes.
Gold and Gold, pot still, coffee still, Nika whiskey, superb whiskey, aged in wood, guaranteed by our own experts.
I've been pronouncing it Nika.
Whatever.
I don't know.
What are you, Japanese?
I speak exactly like four phrases in Japanese because I had 3 weeks to learn Japanese before I went there.
Is one of them, give me more whiskey?
No, one of them is, the number one thing you will say in Japan as an American is sumimasen, which is excuse me.
All right.
And thank you, which is, I was taught in Osaka to say arigato gozaimasu, which is very formal. But
okay.
In Osaka, apparently that is you say arigato gozaimasu.
Let's go ahead and wrap this up. Thanks for listening to this sort of free form away from the template episode. You've been listening to Biker's Dice and Bars, recorded here in Portland, Oregon. If you have any comments on the things that we've talked about, if you want to join Jacob's gaming group, if you want to know more about our stories and shows that we have recommended, check us out on Facebook, on Discord, on, you know, Twitter. What? I should start a live journal community just because.
Yeah, we should. We should.
Bringing it back, baby.
Yes, we should.
Bringing it back.
We're going to bring it back. Yeah,
we're on all of that stuff.
And if you would like to donate to the GoFundMe or the personal funds of my dear friend in Japan who is currently fighting cancer, please message me privately via email or on Instagram. So Poppy Beaujolais at breakfastpuppies.com or at Instagram at Poppy Beaujolais.
So, yeah, thanks for listening. As always, I am NPC.
I am just Jacob.
Dr. Xander Gerrymander.
Poppy Beaujolais.
And once again,
keep a shiny side up.
Always tip your bartender.
May those dice always crit.
And please always drink responsibly.
Unlike us.
I'm responsible.
We're very responsible.
Well, I mean, responsible for getting drunk. Someone snort whiskey up their sinuses. Jesus Christ.
That is not responsible.
That sounds like a personal problem. God damn it, he just finished. There's my... You want some more?
Oh, yeah. One thing we forgot. Folks, we have a new patron.
Whoa, really?
This week.
Awesome.
Miss Ashley is the patron's name. And I do believe Ashley joined us on Discord as well.
Ooh, yeah. Awesome. Thank you.
That's awesome. Thanks, so, Ashley.
Ashley, thank you for contributing. Thank you, Ashley, for contributing to our bills.
Payments. Thank you.
To our words. Yes. Thanks for contributing.
And Ashley. Thanks for joining us, friends.
We've reached the end
of Bikers, Dice, and Bars.
Talking bicycles and motorbikes, gamer things and all the like.
Thanks for joining us, friends. We've reached the end of Bikers, Dice, and Bars. Talking bicycles and motorbikes, gamer things and all the like. You can listen to it in your car. But Bikers, Dice, and Bars.
And Ashley, thanks for joining us, friends.
We've reached the end
of Bikers,
Dice, and Bars.
Talking bicycles and motorbikes, gamer things and all the like.
You can listen to it in your car,
Ashley.
So,
mostly
bars
about
Bikers,
Dice, and Bars.
we may have had a little to drink, Ashley. Yep. We apologize.
Thanks for contributing to our
Thank you so much, Ashley.
Drinking
you,
fund? I don't know.
You are as gorgeous as you are intelligent.
Mm-hmm.
And if you are in the Pacific Northwest and you look us up, we will buy you a drink.
It's
First
true.
Round's on us. It'll be something nice.